What's going on, everybody? Hope you are having a wonderful week so far. Before we start, please subscribe. Please give us some comments or a review. I'd love you forever. I say it every week, I'm sorry. For all those people that have subscribed and gives us the reviews, means a lot. Big love. Podcast time. This week on the podcast, I sat down with the one and only Kshmr. He has had multiple careers in the music industry, starting with the Cataracts and making the hit record Like a G6, to then convert into his Kshmr project, having huge hits with Tiësto, Hardwell. Just released a new album as well, which is based on Indian hip hop. Amazing album. Also delved into lots of other kind of intricacies of his career. So without further ado, the one and only Kshmr. What is going on, man? We are live. How are you?
Good. So good. Good to be here.
Thanks for coming on, man. Thanks for coming on. I really appreciate it.
Yeah. No. It's my pleasure, man. How are you doing?
I'm actually sick right now. I've got a bit of a cold. I went to bed yesterday with it. And I don't feel too great. But third podcast in today, so we're getting it done. So I can't really complain.
Oh, third podcast today.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
How do you do that? Is your brain not fried?
Nah, to be fair, like, kind of used to it because, like, I'm sure it's the same for you. Like, we're nice and busy, right? So the fact is that I can't just do, like, one a week because we release them weekly. I have to, like, batch them out. So we're, like, recording up until, like, the end of March, for the end of March. And then in March, we record up until the end of May, just purely because, like, touring and everything like that just doesn't allow us to kind of do it on a weekly basis. And it's quite nice to have them backed up. It's like, just in case somebody cancels or has to rearrange, it just allows us to make it a bit easier, really. How about you? Where in the world are you?
I'm in Los Angeles. So, yeah, I live in LA. I've been here for the last 15 years.
Nice.
Maybe more. And it's all right. I got a little cold too, but I'm recovered now. And
nice, man.
Even when I'm sick, I sort of feel compelled to keep working a little bit, you know?
Yeah, you kind of have to, right?
I do, yeah.
Did you grow up in America?
I grew up in America, yeah.
Cool, man. You're originally from India?
My dad is from India. And he came from India, and he met my mom going to university at Cal, Berkeley. So that's where they had me, and that's where I grew up. I didn't go to UC. I don't know if you've heard of UC Berkeley. For people that are out there who are familiar, UC Berkeley, it is a really great school. I didn't go there. People are always disappointed when I tell them, I have nothing to do with UC Berkeley. So,
did you go to school at all? Like, did you go to university?
I went for a year, but it was already pretty clear to me at that point that I wanted to do music. So I kind of phoned it in. And by the end of my second semester, you know, the end of the first year, I was ready to leave. So I left and I did the music thing.
Yeah. What were you studying?
Business. It's bullshit, you know? Yeah.
I guess... Hey, some people have got no business, right?
No, yeah, it's not bullshit for everyone. For me, it was bullshit.
Yeah.
For me, it was
bullshit. Because the music business isn't quintessential business, right?
No, it's not. It's its own weird, you know, perverted form of business where it's like, it's, you know, you can't try too hard. You got to be cool. But also at the heart of it is creativity, which no one can quantify. And so... Yeah. So, yeah, you know, it's interesting.
It's an interesting business generally because there's so many artists that talk about how hard it is to do the business thing. And it's really, I'd like to get your take on how you've had multiple extreme successes in your career in music, in the music business, right? There's been multiple streams of revenue that you've and multiple creative endeavors that you've done that's been extremely successful. But I guess my question is to be successful in music, in the music industry, do you really think you have to have a level of business knowledge to become successful? And I mean successful in a financial way.
Yeah. Well, there's different kind of business knowledge also. Like, I would divide it into, you know, sometimes people call it street smarts or something. There's totally. People, I would kind of simplify that more into people who understand leverage. And, you know, and then there's people who just who love crunching the numbers. I've never received a contract that I read all the way through once in my whole life, you know, but I have lawyers to do it, but I'm sure that there were things I left on the table because I didn't read through. And there's people who have a mind for that, who have the patience for that, that can really understand the inner workings of their deal. They know how to finesse their deals to get the most out of it. And then there's other people who, you know, are a little bit bullish, but I've seen them do well with it. You know, I don't want to name too many names, but there was a guy when I was doing pop music, I worked on the Selena Gomez stuff. You know, he was one of these like deal maker kind of guy. He never wrote or, you know, produced or anything, but he linked me up with this amazing guitarist. And the guitarist ended up playing the guitar riff on the Selena Gomez single that I landed. So I go back to him, and I feel like I'm just going to cut a deal with the guitarist. But the guy who middleman it gets in the way, he's like, yo, you know, I kind of set that up, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, it got to a point with the negotiation that Selena Gomez's team was like, yo, if you guys can't figure this out, we're going to go with a different single. So he successfully leveraged himself into that deal and got, you know, in my opinion, a bigger portion of it than he should. And, you know, guitarist was an important part of the song, but probably even got a little more than he should. And, you know, there's guys like that too, who, and then some combination I've also seen of producers who, you know, really drive a really hard line with their numbers. And, you know, sometimes if you can do that day in and day out, that sounds very exhausting and stressful to me to constantly be getting into the confrontations with people. I'm usually just a let's split it all even kind of guy. But, you know, that is a mindset that that works for people. And at the end of the day, good songs are going to be what moves the needle. But how much you milk it. I've seen people do a better or worse job based on their business acumen, based on their acumen in regards to leverage.
Yeah, it's really interesting that I'm not really in the pop world at all. I've done a few dance pop things, but I've not really kind of worked in the quintessential pop world, as you would call it. Yeah. And I can imagine it's the interesting thing that I find in like the electronic kind of scene is that when there's somebody that's being a nightmare on splits or anything like that, the word gets around very quickly.
Yeah.
And those people kind of don't really get worked with because it's just so hard to do deals with them.
Yes. Yeah, that's right. And there are fewer people with a godlike presence, you know. There are some. There are guys, like really big guys, Guetta, Tiesto, that if you were doing a deal with them, I'm not saying that they're like this, but you'd let a few things slide because people just want to have a Tiesto record or a Guetta record or something. In the pop world, it's so like, God, I hope this person will work with me. So you see it everywhere, you know. It's kind of like you hear about in the movie, the film world, how, you know, like, people will get forced to do things in the backroom casting because they just wanted to get their face on the screen or something, you know. It's nothing to laugh about, but you see little versions of that, you know, in the pop music industry a lot because people are writing songs, and they just wish that they could get a cut, you know. They're just hoping they could get a cut. So they make a lot of concessions, and, you see more. The dance music world is a lot more loving, more of an equal playing field, I feel, you know, more collaboration. And
it's more of a community at the end of the day. I think the pop world from an outsider's point of view just feels very like, I need that cut, so because if I get that Beyonce cut or whatever cut that is, it's gonna completely change my career. Which it does. It completely does. It can change everything. And I think, sorry, I'm snotting everywhere right now. and I think it does, and I think that's what people want. Is people want real success, and I think in the electronic world, it's way more I'll scratch your back if you scratch mine, and let's work on it together, and we can work on it for a long period of time. We can work on multiple projects and we can all kind of win. However, yeah, that seems to be changing now because the electronic world is becoming way more pop.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I guess probably at the root of it is the more money enters into a scene, then you get that dynamic increases of gatekeeping and you know, it might not even be the artists themselves, but their team now is extremely business minded. And, you know, that's my music journey in general has been trying to keep the kid in me intact that just cares about creativity and cares about music.
Yeah.
Yeah, as I navigate the world of business, you know.
Yeah, I think that's really important to keep the creativity to one side, and so it just stands alone, because the business can ruin the creativity massively.
Yeah, it can.
Have you ever like experienced that in your own creativity?
Yeah, for sure. So, I mean, when I was doing pop music, the big hit that kind of broke me on the scene was Like a G6.
Yeah.
And, you know, after we made that song, it was, there was an expectation that we would keep recreating the success of Like a G6. And that was a lot of pressure, and it created a mindset that wasn't good of kind of self-imitation. I wanted to keep, kind of pulling from this flower, pulling petals off of this flower, because it worked once, instead of putting myself back in the mindset of what created Like a G6, which was just kind of following what sounded good to me at the time. It was a new sound, putting the distortion on the 808, doing a melody with it. Yeah. You know, that was an exciting sound to me. But instead of saying like, oh, you know, that worked and I should just keep doing that, that's kind of operating out of fear. It's a little bit of fear internally that I don't know if I have a ton of, you know, more great ideas like that. So I just keep on doing that one. And you look around and now you've got this business and everyone around you is telling you that you're that guy, you're the new hit maker, and you don't want to let them down. And, you know, and you got grown men now whose businesses sort of rely on you. And out of fear, I found myself kind of just trying to copy and paste, you know, and that wasn't good. And eventually, I think I realized pop music in general probably wasn't the best fit, so I transitioned to dance music.
To dance music. Yeah. When going back to G6, how quickly did that change your life?
I mean, when it popped off, really quickly. It took a while from the time we completed the song. I got played on the radio a few times, and then was it 6 months to a year later? Wow. It was some weird spark, and then it was just getting played on the radio all the time, and then it went number one and all the rest of it. But at that point, it did change our lives because we had not signed a publishing deal. So you talk about leverage. I mean, we had all the leverage in the world. You know, we had produced the number one song at the time, and so we're walking into different companies and pretty much could ask whatever we want, you know. And
when did that come out?
I think it was 2010.
So that was pre-streaming.
Yeah, for sure. We had YouTube, but we didn't have Spotify, anything like that.
Yeah, and was that was when music could make money, as in sales-wise, to another level, because CDs were still around, right?
Yes. So you would buy music via the iTunes store. I think CDs were starting to be on their way out.
Yeah, I think they were. Yeah, you're right.
But radio was still a big moneymaker. So if you're getting played primetime radio, it's like a quarter or something, and then it really adds up to quite a lot of money.
American radio is very different to radio in the UK.
Okay.
As in, it's very hard in the US to like have a hit song on radio, just purely because the politics behind behind radio in America is the payola kind of scheme. Did you see the record kind of grow in other territories, and how did that help your career?
Yeah, it did grow in other territories. I think it ended up going number one in like 12 different countries, and it chart. Hold on a second. Okay. But when my dog walkers get here, it's gonna go ballistic first. it went number one in a bunch of countries, and it was cool to see. You know, the one country that always let me know ahead of time what was reacting was Australia. So they have their chart. I think it's called the ARIA or something. Yeah. And they would always be supportive of Cataracts, right? That was my group at the time, before they would react in America. So we'd always be checking those charts. And
that's interesting.
There are even other songs, like somebody that I used to know, me and my friends had all rinsed through that song because it had become a hit in Australia first before transferring over, the Gautier song. And we started to kind of look at that as like where we would go to learn about cool new music. It's funny. I didn't really, this is how American I was. The idea of like a song blowing up in Europe was just like, who the fuck cares? I did not give a shit, you know? Yeah. I wasn't aware of how much, you know, money there was and how many people and what a cool scene there was. When you're in America, you think Europe is just like, it's fucking Europe. It's like some second world, you know, countries. Look, I've obviously my opinions have really changed over the years, but we're going back to when I was like, you know, my barely 20 years old and I'd grown up in America. And I remember before Like a G6, the girl who sings Like a G6, her name was Dev. And we were shopping her music around and I was trying to get her a deal. I produced her music and we go in, and I think it was like L.A. Reid or one of these really big guys. I forget who discovered Lady Gaga, but it was him. And we go into this meeting and we're playing a music and he's like, you know, I think this would work really great in Europe. And this was probably the fourth meeting that we'd had. And someone said something to that effect because it was all kind of dancey, you know. And I just busted out of the meeting. I was so fed up. I was like, all right, I guess we're going to fucking Europe, guys. You know, I think it was the dumbest idea in the world. Because I thought he was just shelving us. You know, I thought he was just kind of throwing us under the rug and being. And he was so offended. He told me that he had to take. He was like, all right, I'm going to go finish this deal with Lady Gaga or something. Like, literally said the most LA thing ever. And then walked out of the room. And Wendy, who's our friend who was like helping us get these meetings, she just looked at me and she's like, well, how are you ever going to work in the music business? You know, talk like that. But then G6, you know, you get a hit and all is forgiven. But
yeah, and then everyone likes you again and wants to make money out of you, right?
Yeah, yes. Yeah, you're about as good as the money you're making for people. And I don't look at that as such a cynical thing. I mean, you know, that's. You know, you enter this arena of the music business and it is about usefulness. The problem with pop music is that usefulness is kind of limited to the money you make. In dance music,
of course,
you're still kind of, you know, you get in the crowd, you get with for your usefulness, but it could be more about, you know, the music, new music you bring to the table because you're DJing or your production skill. But you know, some people get a little cynical about the idea of usefulness and, oh, you only like me because I'm useful to you or something. But I don't think that's inherently bad.
No, I agree. I totally agree. I think realistically, everybody has a worth, whether that is $5 an hour or whether that's $5 million an hour. And I think as long as you know what your worth is as a human being to, and I'm talking financial value, I'm not talking anything else value, but just purely value when it comes to business. Yeah. If you know your worth, then I think that's the most important thing. And other people will know your worth as well. Yeah. And until you bring and add more value to other people's business, whether that's a record label, whether that's a publishing company, whether that's a promoter, an agent, a manager, then it all kind of starts there, realistically. And there's extremely talented artists out there that don't have any worth in a financial sense, which means that they don't get any opportunity to kind of move forward. You're muted.
Yeah, I just took it off because there's some sound going on over there. Yeah. Yeah. I agree.
So it's a very like interesting market. I want to go into, you went from working cataracts to then going to Kshmr.
Yeah. So there they go.
You here want they to come.
I just let you hear.
Here they come.
All right. That was pretty smooth. It's because I'm up here. Okay. Thank you. All right. The transition. Yeah. So, you know, fast forward after like a G6, we had become kind of viewed as just pop producer, songwriter duo.
Yeah.
Because Dave had written the song, I had produced the song. We were actually artists, you know, we were singing and rapping on stuff that had kind of gone by the wayside a little bit. The focus became more on developing Dev, doing her album, and then for producing for other people, writing for other people. Some cool things came out of that. Like I got to work on Enrique Iglesias's last album. We became really good friends.
Wow.
I did a bunch of the English songs on there. I did almost all the English songs on the last, on Sex and Love. And then Robin Thicke became good friends with that. That clicked. The New Boys, I did a couple singles that did well for them. Selena Gomez, that was good. And then Beyonce, that was probably one of the last big pop things I did. I
was
went
that out, on Lemonade?
Yeah, it was Partition. Was that on Lemonade?
I don't know.
It was album she put out out of nowhere.
Yeah, I think that was Lemonade, Partition. Yeah. Let me just check. I don't know. I see it though. It did pretty well, put it that way.
Yeah, Partition was good, so I helped with the production on that, and that was just a cool experience because I was in a big house. It's funny, I've never talked publicly about this, but so I got the deal. Oh, it's such a wild story. I guess I'm not really in the pop world right now, so I'll just tell you the story, man. So I had actually stayed up all night, and it was me and my friend getting fucked up, and we were just like obliterated. And in the morning, I get a call from my manager, and it's like 9, 10 a.m., and he's like, yo, I have a meeting with Beyonce's manager. She wants to meet you about working on her new album. And I was like, dude, any other day, like literally any other day. And he was like, there's just a pause on the phone. He was like, all right, man, I guess I'll just tell Beyonce's manager you can't meet today. And I was like, oh no. I was like, okay. I'm going to do it. So I like jumped in the swimming pool, in the swimming pool, just to like freshen up. You know, I just jump in the cold ass pool, and my friend Anthony drives because I can't drive, and I wear sunglasses the whole time. And I walk into this studio, and first thing I see is like Sia is there. He's like an incredible singer, and I've been a fan of since way back in the day. And I'm just like, oh god, like being around celebrities already makes me so nervous. And so whatever, she's like walking by, and then I meet, I believe her name is Teresa, and it was Beyonce's manager, and we sit down, and she's just telling me about the project, asking me questions about, you know, where is my production head at and stuff, and I just give the best pitch I can, you know. I'm like, you know, I think I could bring you that new kind of electronic whatever. So I'm like selling myself, you know, just hoping you know, hoping I'm making any sense. And you know, she's like, all right, well, you know, you'll hear back. And then we hear back, and then I got it. And it was
amazing.
Yeah, so they flew me out to, I guess it was like JFK, and then I get picked up by a driver, and then we go to the Hamptons, and it's some crazy house in the middle of the night. So it was the middle of the night. So I was like, all right, thank God. I'm not going to have to meet anybody when I first get in, because it's probably so late, they'll all be in bed. But I get there and it's like empty. The house is empty. I'm like, all right, I'm just going to go find my room. It's a mega big house. We all get different. And they're like, oh no, everybody's out back. They're having dinner. So I was like, okay, all right. Put my stuff down and I walk out so that it's like a big barbecue, like old, you know, Southern style table. And it's just like Jay-Z, Beyonce, Ryan Tedder, Benny Blanco, I think maybe Sia and Greg Wells, I think is that the name of the guy with producer stuff? And I mean, yeah, and The Dream was there, Hit Boy was there. It was like the most intimidating thing you could walk into, you know? And I like basically shit myself and I'm just like, all right, you gotta say something, you know, and like and I'm just like I was like, wow. You know, I look at Jay-Z and Beyonce, I was like, it's you guys in 3D. And they crack up. I get a little joke and I'm like, all right, thank God. And I knew Benny Blanco from producing pop stuff. So I just go over and I just nestle next to him and I'm like, yo, dude, like what is even happening right now? And then funny story. So Benny tells me it was actually his last day there. And he was like, yo, it was so crazy. You just missed it. Like I was playing hip hop beats and Jay-Z came in. And he just started freestyling over them. And I was like, no way. I was like, that's insane, dude. I was like, seriously? And he was like, yeah, dude. He's like, you should do it. Like, just fucking, you got beats, play him some beats. And so I let it go a few days. Benny leaves. I get, you know, paired up with different sessions throughout the week. And it's such a beautiful vibe, man. Like you come into the kitchen and it'd be like Sia cooking breakfast and singing while she does it, like making eggs and stuff. And like I became good friends with the machine from Florence and the Machine because she was also there. We kind of clicked up. But it was a little bit clicky. Like a lot of like the urban dudes would sort of stay in their own group and do their own thing. Yeah. But Ryan Tedder got a day with him. That was super fun. And so anyway, I kind of like, I'm getting my confidence up. And, you know, I had been sitting around the table. We have dinner tonight, every night together. And so I'd always pick the seat right in front of Jay-Z because I just wanted to hear him talk, you know. And he was like, he was like Bart Simpson. He was just always like saying some like funny shit. And then Beyonce would be super presidential. Everything she said was perfect, you know? And then Jay-Z would always be making like snarky little comments, making fun of people. So I was like, damn, I see why she loves this guy. You know, he's a funny dude. And so I get my confidence up and like, we're all eating dinner and I'm just like, hey man, you know, I started out as a hip hop producer. It'd be cool to play you some beats sometime. And he just doesn't say anything. He just kind of looks at me and he's like, mm-hmm. And in the morning, Teresa, who's running the whole thing, like pulls me aside into my room. And she's like, you know, Niles, this camp is for Beyonce and we want to focus on Beyonce and her. You see, I was like, no, Jay-Z snitched on me. I was like, I made him uncomfortable and he went inside. I just felt so much inner cringe, you know? And then, yeah, anything else funny happened with that?
That's amazing.
Yeah, there's a couple other funny small stories. Like, there's this rapper named Krispy Kreme who was, like, a comedy rapper. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
And he had a line in his first breakout song that was like, I got more money than Jay-Z. Compared to me, Jay-Z is lazy. Plus, Beyonce thinks that I'm cute. It's okay, Beyonce, I think you're cute too, right? And this dude have like 3 million views on YouTube, right? Like never in a million years would he expect like Jay-Z and Beyonce would see it. So at dinner, I pulled out the YouTube video. I was like, yo, you guys got to see this. And I showed them and it got like the biggest laugh. They were dying. Yeah, they were dying. I hope he gets to see this. I think I commented on his YouTube. I was like, I hope you know I fucking showed it. He was probably like, this guy's a quack
that doesn't have a clue. That's so good.
Yeah, there are a couple other stories, like some funny stuff that happened with people, but I don't want to call anybody out in particular.
Do you like doing like sessions like that in the pop world?
Not really. I feel like I don't work well in that format of like, I'm not a traditionally gifted guy. Like, hey, get in with Niles. He's going to break out the piano, start blowing you away. Yeah, a song's going to come together. I'm much more of a, hey, give me some time, I'll craft something. It's probably going to suck the first 10 things I try. And then the 11th will actually be pretty good. And then you come in and do your thing. And, you know, there were a couple of people I hit a really great stride with. Like on the Enrique stuff, I worked with this guy, Marty James, and at Rome, who's the now the singer Sublime. And I worked with, I'm blanking, Julia Michaels on
okay.
And Lindy Roberts, I think it was, on the Selena Gomez stuff, and we really clicked. So there have been a few times along the way, and for anybody who's doing pop music, if you're anything like me, I really recommend that you do the whole session thing. You do a lot of sessions. They're not all going to be great. But when you find people you click with, you recognize it, and then you get their number, and you work with them, and then you get a cycle going. And, you know, we ended up making hits because we had great chemistry, and then we, you know, we said, hey, we'll do more and more sessions together. It's sort of a necessary evil to do the speed dating of sessions to find the people that you really click with. But no, overall, I wasn't the best at it.
Makes sense. Yeah, I think it's also a part in the industry that, like you said, it is a factory. It's a factory of just making records and just hoping that one does well.
Yeah.
Whereas I feel like in the electronic music scene, it's not as like that anymore, or ever will be, really, to a certain extent.
Yeah.
I want to talk about we were kind of going into the transition of Kshmr.
Right.
What was the reasoning behind that? Where did you go from, like, why? What kind of made it?
That's a good question. Well, I felt like our artist project was starting to stall out a little bit. And I think David, my partner, recognized it before me. And he wrote me an email one morning. And he was like, listen, I'm sorry I couldn't tell you in person. I don't know, I couldn't do it. This isn't for me anymore. And I want to go travel.
Yeah.
And so he wanted to just travel. He went to China. And I tried to do the cataract solo for a while. But it was clear that once you plateau, you're probably only going to start going down, you know? Unless you have some big vision, some big spark. So I was starting to get interested in dance music. And I loved watching, like, I remember Hardwell at Ultra. I was like, this is like peak existence, you know, like what a feeling to be in that crowd, the songs, the level of production. It was a whole nother level from the shit that I was creating. You know, to me, I was like, that just sounds huge. And I wanted to get into it, but I saw guys like Will.i.am doing that transition in a way that felt corny to me. So I wanted to do it right. And for me, that meant ghost producing at first. That would be my way to get my feet wet. And I had a friend in Los Angeles. He was a good friend. He was a promoter at the clubs, and he was also a DJ. He'd take us out, and, you know, he expressed to me that he didn't know how to produce, and he wasn't really interested in learning, but he loved DJing, and he wanted to have some original tracks. So, you know, I was like, hey, I'll work with you. You know, you got a lot of ideas. I'll help you produce them. And so we did this for a while. You know, people look at ghost producing as an ugly thing. It wasn't really an ugly thing. It was a pretty, you know, we were friends. It was working. And totally. When he played shows, I would get a split of the shows, you know, so it was fair.
Amazing.
And so one of the songs ended up being really big. It was Tsunami. And then I was, you know, Spinnin, who put this record out, they were a little bit interested in who I was. And then so I told them about my whole vision for this Kshmr project, which, you know, I wanted it to be dark and cinematic, and I'd incorporate these Indian sounds into it. And they, you know, they heard me out. They were a little bit like, all right, dude, like, you made one.
Who is this dude?
You made one big room song, like, you know, maybe you just got lucky. But they took a chance on me and let me. And to be fair, a lot of my first songs were just kind of whatever, big room songs. But slowly my chops got better. And that's the thing, as your technical skill catches up, you can start having fun. And you can start incorporating all the things that make you into it. Because you're not just bound to what you're able to come up with. once your skill set catches up, now you could do anything and you get to be more creative. You say, well, I could, out of everything I could do, maybe I want to put some Indian sounds and dance songs together. And if you have the production skills to execute, then you can do it in a way that everyone could digest. You could take fairly weird ideas if your production skills are good enough and make people get it. Because when that beat hits, it hits, and you can bring them along the way. You sort of slowly bring them into sounds they ordinarily wouldn't used to, because you know what nerves to hit that will make them like it regardless. The beat hits right and everything. So I found I really blossomed with the Kshmr part. The same thing I told you about, maybe in a session I'm not the best because I'm better when I have my own time to work and massage out an idea. With dance music, that's all you do. You just sit there and you try a thousand different things and you massage out a different idea. So it really was a wonderful situation for me. Yeah.
It sounds amazing. I think it's also from an outsider's point of view, it sounds like there's zero pressure going into that situation, where with the cataracts, there was all the pressure because you've had these hit records and it's like, now I need to recreate those hit records. Whereas when you're going into a new project, there's like, I'm literally a nobody in this project.
I
don't have to do anything, and there's no expectation. And I think there's something very freeing on an artistic level that can allow you to just really put the time into what you want to do.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. You know, as the years go on, I maybe feel a little bit of that, but nowhere like pop music. When I say a little bit of that, like, you know, you look at the songs that do well, and of course, it's nice to keep everything running, to, you know, have some songs that do well every year. And mostly when I play the live show, if it's been a while, if I'm, most of the songs I'm playing that people give a shit about are like 5 years old, I'm like, I'd love to have a new one, you know? I think that's
normal though, right? I think that's every musician's kind of like crux of like, we get big based on a few records, and they're the records that everybody wants to hear until we have another big record,
right?
And it's kind of salty, but also my old management used to say to me, if you went to see the Rolling Stones and they didn't play their biggest hits, but they just played the new album, how would you feel about that?
Right.
And I think it was a very like real, it opened my eyes and I was like, makes sense. People are buying tickets based on our biggest records. They're not buying tickets to hear us play our new record that they've never heard and they don't really give a fuck about.
Yeah.
At the end of the day.
Right.
Until they give a fuck about that new record.
Right.
It's hard. It's a really hard one when you're being an artist, because all you want is your new record to do well, and all you want is people to hear your new record.
True.
But it's a tough one. Yeah. It's a really tough battle.
Yeah, it is. It is tough. You know, it's funny. I was just thinking about this yesterday. It could be really... You could be very tempted to sort of judge yourself and that pressure that you're talking about based on today or based on the last week, but... If you think about yourself in terms of one big picture, everything that you've done, all the hard work you put in, I think you go a lot easier on yourself and you bring a lot more joy in, because you allow yourself to be proud of all the amazing things you've done and all the hard work that you put in. And that mentality of just, but what did you do today, or what did you do this week or something? I'm not trying to promote, you know, resting on your laurels, but... It's not like that mindset of lacking is going to make you make better music anyway, you know?
I think it does the absolute opposite.
Yeah.
If I'm honest, I think when you're in the situations of foe is me and I'm not doing well at this moment in time and I'm not at the top of my game, I don't think that helps any creative endeavor.
It doesn't, yeah.
And I think it's like... I think it's also, what are you comparing it to? What are you comparing it to? Are you comparing it to yourself? Are you comparing it to your old successes? Or are you comparing it to other people's current successes?
Yeah.
Which you can't actually compare. We all do, right? Like, how many times have you looked at that artist and gone, how the fuck are they doing that?
Yeah.
Like, realistically, like, but you're never going to be that artist and they're never going to be you.
Right. Yeah. And
it's a tough one to look at, though. It's a tough one to process.
Yeah. Yeah. You have to... It helps to believe that your journey is just your journey, and what you do with today and making the most out of today is all that matters. And the whole success thing, who's selling out these huge shows and blah, blah, it's kind of up to the universe to decide. You can do your best to like make that possible in the universe by like being your truest form of self in your music. Usually when you see people really connecting on a big level, it's because they've kind of sharpened this knife of who they are and delivered it to the world. And they represent something that the world is gravitating towards right now. They're being very vulnerable, open. Like John Summit is just totally himself right now. You know, I mean, I'm sure he's always been. I mean, I was even watching his funny little tutorials he do on YouTube. He's been the same guy. And the universe at this moment has caught up to it. And they're like, we're fucking into it. You know, all he really did, I don't think he needed to, you know, of course he had a great song, was a big hit, Where You Are, I Want to Be, yeah, I think Where You Are. But all he needed to do was keep being himself. And he, and as far as I could tell, he's done a fantastic job of that. So if there's any lesson there, it's kind of just like to be yourself in the purest form. And when the universe wants you to be a big star, or if it does, then that happens, but it's probably only harmful when you look around and you feel a sense of lacking, because that's not happening to you right now. You know,
it's
really up to you.
Yeah,
you
really can't force anything.
Yeah.
Like you might have the best record in the world, and if, especially nowadays, if it just doesn't connect, there's nothing, you can't force a record to connect.
Yeah.
You can't force people to listen to it. You can't force a virality of a record.
Yeah.
Whereas it, I feel like you used to be able to a certain extent.
Yeah.
But now there's so much now. There's so much content out there that it's just so hard to get through the noise. And hey, I think when you're being organically and authentically yourself, it adds so much value to your project generally.
Yeah. Yeah, it does. And in dance music, I think you get really especially rewarded for that. Maybe in a way that you don't get as much in pop music. You know, like there are guys who maybe don't even have big hits, but by them representing something really authentic to the community, they'll be booked year after year at festivals. And you go to them and they're a vibe. You know, because they're authentic. The dance music community really cares about that, I think.
I think if you look at a lot of the like OGs in dance music, like Kevin Saunderson's, DJ Bones, like Carl Craig, like all these, Jeff Mills, all the like OGs of techno and house, Mr. G, Derek Carter, like although I feel like they should be getting booked more and should be getting paid more because they are the creators of the genre that we call electronic music, they're getting booked regularly and they still have a great career purely based on what they did 20 years ago.
Right.
And I find that really special. And I feel like we don't necessarily have that in the pop world.
Yeah. I know, it's kind of crazy. In the pop world, it's like you could do something so big and so magical and it takes the world by storm. But then a couple of years go by and it's like, all right, but what did you do this year? You know, it's, there's something kind of American about it. Like, you know, it's like, it's, you know, we work at more days of the year than any other country. And and this, I guess nowadays there's a word for it, the hustle mindset. You know, there's like, there's kind of like two trains of thought on the internet. It's either like, yo, take a break and sleep for the next 12 hours. You deserve it. or like you're going to be nothing for the rest of your life if you don't read 12 books today and fucking turn $10 into $10 million by next year. You're a piece of shit, you know?
Literally.
Yeah.
Literally. Where do you sit on that mindset?
Where do I sit on that mindset? I guess I'm just more about finding the situation that get, like, there's a feeling that I associate now with, like, I'm on the right path. And I'm always trying to get towards that. And accepting that it's not always music even. Like, I'll do things that make me feel a sense of growth and learning. And for a while, it was trapped for me because if it didn't fit with music, then it didn't fit with the whole game plan. It's not going to fit with the money. It's not going to fit with anything. And now I'm a little bit looser where, if it's music, if it's a new idea, something that excites me, I'll pursue that. To get that feeling of a new challenge, a new reward, a new growth. But recently I started playing around with Unreal Engine, which is totally separate from music.
Yeah.
I actually was into making little games as a kid. That was before I got into music. I was into making little computer games. I would go to camps and learn. At the time it was Flash. And now the cutting edge software is Unreal Engine. And you can use it not only to make games, but you could use it to make 3D renders. So you could do character animation and things like that.
Yeah.
And that was fascinating to me. So I'm allowing myself time to not feel guilty about it, even though it's not related to music, to invest into that, to learning. And I'm so proud of my little, you know, I got a character to animate, to run down this hill, and it looks good. And that was a big reward for me because it was new grounds to go. How it relates, maybe it'll come back and I could use it for visuals for the Kshmr project or something. But that feeling, even though there's no pressure for it to fit into everything.
Yeah.
I think that's where we get stuck is like once you get enough going for yourself, there's a pressure for everything you do to fit and be in furtherance of your main career in some way.
I agree.
And the bad thing I would call it that all bad things lead to is losing yourself. Like you get this decoherence of who you are and what you're doing. See, what you're doing now is influenced by how it fits in your business and all these things. And so you start telling yourself that, no, I really love doing this. Because if you don't love doing it, now the whole thing is a jumble. Wait, what do you mean? You don't love doing the thing that makes you all the money? It's like sends your whole body into identity crisis. So you want to reconcile these two. And you want to start telling yourself that you're passionate about something because it works. And really the bad thing that I'm getting to, the end result, is you're losing sight of who you are.
Yeah.
And when people talk about like follow your dream, the reason not everybody does it is because we've had a life of confusing our dream and who we are to a point where we get out of touch with it because it's unrealistic, because it doesn't fit with the way things go. And like once your compass gets fuzzy, it's like this slippery slope of like people just not even knowing what they want. And I could feel that sometimes too. Like, I think what I want is this, but is it just that because I'm scared of what it means if I don't want that? You know, if I don't want that thing, then my whole identity goes into crisis. So trying to just be very honest and accepting of that feeling, to be in tune with that good feeling of what growth feels like, new challenges feel like, that's like a deeper sense of contentment. That's, you know, after, you know, it's not the money, it's not all that stuff. And to allow myself to pursue that, even when it doesn't align with all these other things that have become solidified in my life, you know, that's
I really like that. I really like that a lot. And I can relate to that massively. How do you step away from being the identity of the artist, as in, because I think kind of in context, I think it's very easy for us when we're doing something that we absolutely love, our hobby, it turns into a job.
Yeah.
Then that becomes our whole identity. Like I'm Will Clarke, the DJ, producer, podcaster, right?
Yeah.
And I'm that to pretty much everybody that meets me, apart from anything to do with my family or like anything outside of kind of work related thing. But there's a lot more to me than just that. Okay. But it's very easy to kind of get caught up in that and to go, maybe this isn't what I want to do for the whole of my life.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe, but then it's like, what do I want to do?
Right.
And then do I make that other thing my identity? Let's say, for instance, I wanted to get into fashion. I wanted to get into fragrance, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Like, does that mean that the music side has to stop? Like, do you ever battle with things like that?
Yeah, you know, I mean, I think I think one thing that could help is not looking at it as so binary, you know?
Yeah.
You know, there's a function that that serves. You're Will Clarke, the DJ, the producer. There's respect with that. There's money that comes with that. There's a lot of things that, you know, your body's not going to be quick to let go of. You know, it might send some red alerts off. Like, what do you mean we're going to give all the shit up? But if you went a month without it, you know, you think, how much does it really change? If you gave yourself a month just to try other things, just to absolve yourself for a month of that identity and you know, your body, I don't know, you might be different, but it's going to want to resume the cycle. So maybe you make a list of things that you're going to try for a month, and you go and try them and you get back in touch with yourself. That's, you know, free from all that. You block music out completely for a month, and that's what I'm planning to do come May. I don't have any touring, and I'm just going to not do any music, nothing. Maybe I'll get deeper into Unreal. I might travel a little bit. You know, another thing I think about is the city I'm living in. Do I even love it, or is that part of my loop also? So I want to
100%.
Yeah, poking at the loop 100%. A little bit, and it doesn't mean you give up the other thing completely, but you could poke at the loop a little bit. You could see, do I really like this loop still? It, of course, worked for me at one point, you know, but it doesn't mean it'll work forever. But if you don't poke at it, then that you'll be in that fucking loop. I mean, loops don't want to unloop. They'll keep looping. You know what I mean?
100%. Yeah. 100%. Talking about loops, this is kind of a nice little
like I know.
Splice.
Yeah.
You have had an extremely successful career on Splice.
Yeah.
Where did that come from?
So Splice originally was a collaboration platform that would try to facilitate some of the annoyances of working with people in different projects. So it would carry over the samples that the other person doesn't have. It was a really great idea. And at the time, I was friends with the people. I still am friends with them, but... You know, it was a small company. I was good friends with the owner, with the kind of ground team. And I wanted to be involved with it. I invested, I think Tiesto had just invested in it. And, you know, they were doing okay with the collaboration thing. But then when they introduced the marketplace, it was clear this was going to be really big. And they had carried over, they had migrated some packs from a website that they licensed because they wanted to get a database going with the subscription plan. And I said, well, you know, I've been thinking about doing a sound pack. Why don't I just do it with you guys? And they were like, yo, that would be sick. So I inadvertently became the first artist pack on what would end up being the home for all artist packs. And they pushed it really hard because it was, you know, a Splice pack, everything, you know, it was like a full collaboration. They put it on the front of the page and it had that snowball effect because it gained that familiarity right away. When the second one came out and I made it even bigger and better, that did well. It charted the third one. And you know, I'm grateful that they've just been living in the top chart. And, you know, I give them my fucking all. I will say it's an interesting lesson about how important it is to be first. Like in news, they say it doesn't matter who's right. It matters who's first. And, you know, at this point, like Skrillex with dubstep music, there was probably a point where other producers had maybe outpaced him in terms of the product, how big they can make it sound, all that stuff. But you really associate him with bass music because he was one of the first to put on such a international scale to make it mainstream. And Kygo, the same with Tropical House. People who are the first at something. End up really, you know, they get their spot solidified sort of in the minds of people. So for me, that in the sound packs, I was lucky enough to be first on this platform. And I love making those sound packs. It's harder in some ways than making songs, but easier in other ways, because all you got to do is make one catchy little thing and you render it. And it's good for the kind of dopamine reward system when I'm in the cycle of creating a pack.
100%. How much work goes into them?
Oh boy, it's only gotten more and more. So the last pack, from the time we started to time we finished, was a year and a half.
Wow.
And it started with a house that I rented where I invited all these producers to come in. I'd pay them a day rate. These really talented guys. and we would work. I'd give them goals for the day, and we'd come back with different kind of loops, different kind of drums, whatever. We had a room in the house that was the drum room, so we recorded the shit out of a bunch of drums. That probably led to kind of like a raw influx of maybe 5,000-6,000 sounds that we'd go through, find the best ones, edit them. And then I did another couple of weeks just with instrumentalists, where I basically prepared a bunch of beats, and I would have these incredible flute players, saxophone players, violin player, you name it, come in and freestyle. So it was very important that these people were good at improvising, because I would play a bunch of different beats and I would just get them to improvise. And then the talk back would be on constantly. And if they did something cool, I'd say, hey, that was great. Let's just refine it a little bit. Let's do a few takes. And, you know, then you've got fucking 10,000 recordings to comp through. So that was fun. Comping is just takes so long. And then, of course, I realized that there was a lot of stuff that we didn't have that I wanted to get. So in the months that preceded, you know, it's probably 6 months of just looking at other packs, what they did well, being like, all right, I'm going to spend a few days working on this kind of sound. Sometimes when it was small things that I couldn't do, I go on Fiverr. I got a great ukulele player who could also whistle. So he did whistle loops, did ukulele loops, got vocalists. You know, it was the packs really intend to be a one-stop shop where you don't need any other pack. You could pretty much just produce with this. At least that's the goal. I go in with that mindset, and I'm so proud of them. I'm proud of them like I'm proud of albums. When I'm done with the packs, I go re-listen to them, and I'm like, listen, I was like, that's a good one. That's a good one. That's a good one. And yeah, I'm just so, I'm so proud of them. And the organization, I'm so proud of. Unfortunately, Splice sort of butchers my organization, if I'm being honest. So I'm, when you buy it directly through my website, through Dharma, you get the organization I intended, and you get more sounds as well. So it, look, they're both great options, but I will say the organization is better for sure on the one.
Yeah, I miss that to a certain extent on, because obviously we come from the days of sample packs before Splice.
Yeah.
And I miss the whole buying a whole pack and having it on your on your laptop, and like being able to go through all the individual folders and going, okay, here's some kicks, here's some tops, here's some melodies and things like that. Whereas now it's kind of like with Splice, it's like, okay, let's search for something.
Yeah,
it feels a little less. I get it, but
yeah, you feel you're not as likely to.
It's not as creative. It's not as like you're not going to come across a gem just because you're going through the pack. You're like being very specific on what you want, and then you type it in,
right,
and then it might be there or it might not.
Yeah, it becomes much more intentional. Yeah, it becomes much more intentional, and music is all about messing up, you know, accidentally discovering something, and
So talking about what you were saying with your Splice packs being albums, you've just released an album. How's this process?
So I mean, you know, I was just talking about pursuing things that may be tangential or even unrelated to your main business, your main identity, being able to let that wiggle a little bit. And so this was a hip-hop album with all Indian artists, and
amazing,
you know, that was all those things. It was a challenge. It was new. It was a genre I hadn't done for a while, and it was a great process. So, you know, to go back a little bit, I was, you know, I'll keep up with Bollywood movies, and one was making noise. It was called Gully Boy, and it was about a rapper who, you know, kind of comes from the slums, works his way up, sort of like an 8 Mile thing. And and the movie was fantastic. It was great, and it got me so interested. Like, is hip hop having a moment in India right now? Because when I was young, I was into hip hop. You know, I remember being on my way to India with like Purple Haze, the Cameron album on, and my headphones. And, you know, and then I get there and it's like, no one's even heard of hip hop. You know, that's what it felt like in India, at least where I was. And to see that all of a sudden there was this burgeoning hip hop scene, I was like, what is going on here? And so I learned that the movie was loosely based on this guy Divine, and they had used some of his songs in the movie. And so I was like, all right, I want to check out him. And I got in touch with him, did a song with him. And then I was so into the process and realized there's so many other great rappers that I wanted to just go out and fully do an album. So the process was basically putting together about 50 or 60 beats ahead of time and then going out to India and spending 10 days or 2 weeks in the studio with like a couple people every day in the studio, getting as much as I could in that first go. And then I had to go out again to get a few more things, but it was mostly a matter of producing and making sense of it at that point. And I also wanted, to back up a little bit more before recording with the people, my point person, Ayushman, who helps me with everything in India, you know, he had this idea, maybe we should do a story, like a story that takes place, that the listener hears via interludes throughout the album. And when we work with rappers, we tell them about the moment in the story that we'd like to take on so that the content of their raps is sort of specific to a particular idea. Rather than letting them go off the cuff, maybe go into the usual habit of talking about how cool they are and, you know, the money they have and this and that, get them to put themselves into the shoes of this character at a given moment in the story. And that could be a creative way to get new ideas to emerge, maybe get something different out of the artist that you're not used to seeing. And that ended up being really great. The artists were really receptive to it. And it was an interesting lesson that, you know, as a producer, when you go into a room with someone and you're trying to get something new, you're trying to get something fresh out of people, get their best work out of them, applying some restraints can expand the creativity in a way. Because rather than a blank page now, you're saying, hey, if this is your, what's the word? These are your parameters, sort of. You know, work within that. It's almost freeing a bit. They're like, all right, I'm not going to use every tool in the shed. I'm just going to, what could I do with a wrench and a screwdriver, you know? And then some magic will come out of that. It's a bit more focused.
I agree. I really like that concept generally of limitations in the studio. So I think it's really empowering because if you do limit yourself, you just have to master one thing.
Right.
And I think it's really special. I've always wanted to do that where you have literally one drum machine, one synth.
Yeah. Do you do that? What's your process like?
So I've also recently just written an album. By the time this comes out, the first single is about to come.
Oh, sweet.
I've been through a very strange period in the last like 18 months where I kind of just got a bit bored of writing club music, like quintessential club music, what I'm known to kind of write and put out and release. So I, 2022, I really wanted to kind of just change everything of how I write music and process. I've always written, like similar to you, what you were saying is I've always just written inside my studio by myself. Occasionally had vocalists come in, occasionally like, and me just finding samples. But what I wanted to do is work with other people and kind of create my own samples and then go and rework it and work with somebody else on like a more regular basis of like on a production level or better musicians than what I am.
So
for me it was like very much of a creative, how I'm working at this moment in time is I'm going in doing sessions with people and then coming out and pretty much remixing those records. So whether I go in with like, I don't know, my most recent session was with a guy that's like an insane, like almost like punky pop guy that can play the piano in an unbelievable way. And we just made this like ballad, like this like love song, really.
Wow.
And then how do I then go and convert that into some sort of a Will Clarke electronic record?
Yeah.
And then kind of just bash it until it's done.
Yeah, wow. I love that.
It's really interesting. I want to write songs. My goal is to write songs. It's not to write club records. And by actually writing the song initially and then turning it into electronic record, or then turning it into some sort of more electronic-esque record, whether it's like a breakbeat record, whether it's like a down tempo something, it just kind of allows, the limitation is the song.
Yeah.
And just being able to kind of work around that song, because I'm using it as a sample. I'm not using it as a new piece of record.
Right. So the song could be anything. And your machine is kind of still dance music that you're going to put it into. But what you're doing is creating such a wide, diverse range of input into that machine. That's another great way to kind of break your loops, is because, all right, now instead of forks and knives, we're giving you fucking spatulas, and we're giving you some random shit that's not, you know, and now we're saying cook with this, you know, and now it's the same machine. Like, see, the Will Clarke machine is still the same genius. You don't want to get rid of that, but you're now putting new input into it, and you're allowing that input to be diverse, and it could be a ballad, and it could be, see, I think that's so great. Now, when you talk about the working with someone else on production, see, I would really love to do that. But what was your criteria going into it? How did you go about finding someone that you could work with on production?
Mine was get somebody in the room that's better than me at something than I am, but also I'm better at them at something.
Yeah.
So for me, I work quite closely with a guy called Mitch Jones now.
Okay.
On the more song-based stuff. And what Mitch is a great producer. He's done quite a lot of pop production, but what he's very good at is he's one of the best piano players I've ever worked with in my life.
Yeah.
But he also knows his way around the production.
Wow.
So what I can do is be like, hey, Mitch, can you play something like this?
Yeah.
Or can you just jam over this?
Yeah.
And then I'll pick out bits that I'm absolutely loving.
Yeah.
And we just do studio days where we get the original song that I've written in a studio session and go, let's delete all the music, let's open a new project, and let's just put the top line on there.
Okay.
And let's just see what we can do. Do we change the key? Do we pull up my drum machines and just write a fucking crazy beat?
Yeah.
Do we go on Splice and just see if we can find this crazy sample?
Yeah.
And for me, again, it goes back to what you were saying, is find somebody that you can work with really well and just home in on that.
Yeah.
It's a fun process because we're both bringing expertise in that both of us don't have of each other.
Yeah.
And we're both, the ego is so far removed from our sessions. It's just about, can we create something that we both love? And that's really special to me. It made me enjoy music, writing music again.
Oh, I love that. I think I'm gonna do.
It's a hard one, man.
I think I'm gonna do.
It's a hard one.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna do that, man.
I'm in LA the whole of April. Let's do it.
Yeah. Why don't we do it?
Let's do it. Yeah. Why not?
Yeah. That sounds fun.
I think that's the interesting thing is like, it's very easy as a producer for me, and I'm sure for you, just to sit in the studio and just write the same thing over and over again.
Yeah.
And especially when we've had some level of success, right? And you kind of hear that over and over again with artists. And I think there's a level of commerciality that we are asked to do that same thing, kind of exactly what you were saying with what you went through with the cataracts, is that you're just kind of regurgitating.
Right.
But I think there's a level of regurgitating and reinventing yourself that you can do if you tell the story correctly to your fans.
Yeah.
And I think that's the hard bit, is go create some amazing shit. Then how do you tell the story to your fans? And then how do you gain more fans from telling the story from your new stuff?
Yeah.
And that's the thing that really interests me, of like how to do it. Because you look at so many massive artists. I just had Moby on the podcast.
Yeah.
Like, you go from listening to what he's done in the 90s compared to what he's doing now.
Yeah.
And you're just like, how the fuck has he done that?
Yeah.
Realistically.
Yeah.
But he's done it.
Yeah.
And there's definitely ways to do it. It's just finding that. It's just enjoying it again.
Yeah.
Because if you believe in something truly, no matter how successful it is commercially, I don't know, tell me if I'm wrong, but we all want it to be commercially successful, yeah, right? Because it's our careers. But I think there comes a point where if I just love that record that's come yeah out, I love that record.
Yeah.
And that's the most important thing.
Yeah. It's the same high, maybe even a better high than something, you know, being successful. It's when you know, like, you know, there's a quote, like, a man who knows he's right has no fear, you know?
Yeah.
When you just believe in something, like that, I did an album, Harmonic Andromeda, and I was like, this is just so creative and awesome and like a feat of production. That it was, yeah, and it didn't get nearly, you know, every song on average didn't get nearly as many plays as my other stuff, but I've almost never been so proud of something because of,
yeah,
just I'm listening to it. I'm like, I'm a fan of this, you know, this is great. Yeah.
I love that. I love that because I was listening to a Zane Lowe interview ages ago. This is probably like 2 years ago. And I can't remember who the artist was. And Zane asked the artist, who are you listening to at the moment?
Yeah.
And the artist turned around and was like, myself.
Yeah.
And I was like, that is the biggest dick move in the world I've ever heard.
Yeah.
But that you can take the ego out of that and you can go, you know what, that artist is literally making music that they love so much that that's all they want to listen to.
Yeah.
And I think there's something really special about that because it's like you're not taking influence, or maybe you are taking influence from other places, but it's not about trying to beat anyone else. It's purely about trying to beat yourself and make the best possible music you can make.
Yeah.
Which is, there's something beautiful about that in a non-commercial way.
No, it is. I don't know why I just pictured like the man's not hot guy when he said it. I was like, it's exactly what he would say. I love that guy so much, by the way. But yeah, it's funny, I got in trouble for a tweet that when I made that album, I tweeted out something like, I think this is one of like the best dance albums of all time. And yeah, I was like, I just can't imagine anybody else taking you on this journey, or, you know, I said something like that. Oh man, I got flamed. I got absolutely ripped apart by the internet.
I hate that though, yeah, because you're allowed your opinion, right? Yeah. And if that's your opinion,
yeah,
then why aren't you allowed that? Like, everyone else is allowed their opinion.
Yeah.
Everyone.
Yeah.
Everyone tells us their opinion on a daily basis on the internet.
Yeah.
So why not fucking put yours out?
Yeah, people don't love it when you big up yourself that much, you know? And it's hard to describe, you know, when I think about music and even the music I make, it's not me. It's not like I'm saying I'm awesome. It's like, yeah, the right things came together to make this awesome, you know? And totally. We talk about, like, you know, one issue with Splice is you find the sample you're looking for, sure, but you don't find the samples that you're not looking for. And music, the beauty of music is, yeah, a lot of accidents, a lot of things that you don't know what the hell is going to happen, but along the way it works itself out. And the magic is almost not even your own. It's like something, yeah, that you were there to foster, but at a certain point, it's like the universe made this happen.
Yeah.
I don't think it's like a big ego thing when you're really in love with something that you've made.
I agree.
You know, it was only happy anyway, totally really, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. No, I totally agree, man. I really do totally agree. And I think, like, we're very fortunate that we have people following and supporting our music, but if we don't support our own music ourselves,
yeah,
then why can we expect anybody else to support our music?
Yeah, it's true. It's true. And you look around and you see people who do really well at things. It's usually what you would describe as this delusion, right? This delusion that they, yeah, believe so much in something, but that's what it takes to pursue music, which is not, you know, there's no glory in this job for many years before anything, yeah, happens. You need that delusion. You need to not, yeah, just like things, but love them and be like, you know, you're like a soldier for this thing. You believe it so much, you know, and some people don't have that bug as much. And it's usually, I mean, you look at Trump, you know, and how Trump has been elected, and I feel he's probably gonna get elected again, if I'm being honest, because, you know, it's usually the strongest dream in the room, you know, that wins.
Yeah.
Not the guy who's like, you know, but maybe this. Even though that guy who's explaining all the shades of gray of a situation, he's probably right. You should probably listen to that guy. Yeah. But who people get led by, and someone who's probably more effectual, that can actually take something to the finish line, is someone who has this extreme passion. And you should have that for what you're doing. Otherwise, you know, you're going to be this iffy guy who is changing the snare on this song. And I asked, you know, like 8 months later, you're working on the same song, changing the snare, you know. I know a lot of guys like that, and it takes like loving things even in the face of it not being perfect. You think it's the best, and people could poke holes in it, but you just let, you know, you push that out of your mind because you believe in this. And society in general will try to dissuade you from being so passionate. It'll kind of remind you of all the things you're missing, but you didn't think about this, and well, it's not actually great. This guy did it better, and it's kind of on you to be delusionally in love with what you're creating.
I agree, and I think that is a perfect way to end this this episode. Delusional. Dude, thank you so much for coming on.
Yeah.
I really appreciate the conversation. I think there's a lot of it. Insight for a lot of people to kind of take from it, so I really appreciate
it. No, thank you, man. It's wonderful, really.
How can people get involved with the project? How can people listen? How can people follow you, etc., etc.?
Yeah, it's just my name, Kshmr, but it's spelled Kshmr, so it's just Kshmr without the vowels, Kshmr. You know, Instagram and Spotify and all those things, and yeah, that's it. You got Google, you'll find me.
Sure. You'll find it. Dude, thank you so much. Keep safe, and I'll see you soon.
Thanks, man. Peace.
Big love to everybody for coming on. Thanks to Kshmr for coming on as well. Really appreciate that. I hope you enjoyed it. Please give us a review. Please subscribe, and I'll catch you next time.